Hello everyone, I want to welcome you to today's class. Today we'll be talking about chemical equilibrium and what that means and its application to chemistry. Let's move from there. First and first, I have a beautiful quote from Obama, the first black president of the United States. Let's see what he has to say. He says, if you are walking down the right path and you are willing to keep walking, eventually you make progress. Obama said this. Obama is an orator and a motivator. He was the one that broke every barrier to tell us that no matter who you are, you can achieve whatever you want to achieve. And that is an important message to all of us today. All right, let's take it off from there. Our learning objectives in this class will include the following. Number one, we'll write equilibrium expressions and use it to calculate, we're going to use it to calculate what the numerical value of equilibrium constant. And then, so we're going to write expressions, we're going to use that to calculate, and then we're going to use what we call the Lechetelier's principle, I'll tell you what it means, in predicting the shift in equilibrium for reactions that are reversible. So we're going to look at these two main objectives, that is, those are what we're going to be covering in this lecture. Let's take it up immediately and move on. Chemical equilibrium. Chemical equilibrium is when the rate of a forward and a reverse or the backward reaction are equal. That's what we mean by a chemical equilibrium. You know, in all the, since we started talking about chemistry, we've never talked about that the reaction can also go backwards. A situation arises whereby a reaction can also go from the product to the reactant, not just from the reactant to the product. And that is what we call a backward reaction. Now, this is the generic forward reaction. So this type of situation whereby at a point in time, the rate of this forward reaction equals the rate of this backward reaction, we say that equilibrium has been achieved. So at equilibrium, usually, the concentration of the product and the reactant are constant. In fact, that particular concentration is what we call the equilibrium concentrations. Equilibrium concentrations. When we achieve equilibrium, the concentration of the product at that point in time will never change. Now remember, students usually make this mistake. They are not equal. What they are is just, they are constant. They don't change. I didn't say they are equal, but I said that they remain unchanging or they remain constant. So if you look at this diagram here, representing energy, of course, we talked about the energy diagram already. So assume we are talking about energy and then concentration of reactants and product form, you found that when a reaction started initially, at this point, let's believe that this reaction is just a ball that's rolling down the hill. At this point, you have 100% of the reactant. That's what we have here. And the moment the reactant will start, remember in rate of chemical reaction, which is the first part of this lecture, we said that as the reactants react, they disappear. And part of them that disappear forms the product. Now, at this 100%, you have 0% of the product. You don't have any product here at all. So you have 0% of the product. Now, as this reaction begins to go, the product begins to appear and this one begins to disappear. Now, at this point, when the reaction is complete, again, what do you have here? You have one. The reactant now becomes 0%. When the reaction is complete, this is 0% reactant. That's what we have here. And then here you have 100% of the product. That's what we have here. Now, so what it means is that, you see, this is an equilibrium reaction now. Because this ball is going to roll and get to this side. And by the time it gets beyond this half point, it becomes the product. And this one is going to roll over by this side and they keep rolling. Because if you look at these two places, this is a gradient. A gradient is something that can tell it can take place. So that means both of these reactions can easily occur spontaneously on both sides of the reaction. So this type of reaction is what we call a reversible reaction. And when we get to this point, whereby, if you look at this now, this is the minimum energy. At this minimum energy is when we say equilibrium has been achieved. That is the point of what? Least energy. And that is where we have achieved equilibrium. Or we can say point of least energy at this point, let me write it at this point. So this is what we call that the rate of the ball rolling this way and the rate of this one rolling this way, that becomes equal at this point, because this is where they meet, and then they now begin to go. So this is how we can easily dramatize what equilibrium is all about. Let's go to the next one. Now, position of equilibrium. You see, the position of equilibrium is a relative indication of which side of the equilibrium lies. Now, equilibrium can lie either to the right or to the left. Now, when equilibrium is to the right, what it means is that you have more of the product of forming, and when it is to the left, you have more of what? The reactant. So position is said to be to the right when the concentration of the product are significantly higher than those of the reactant. The opposite is when it is to the left. Remember, this is to the right. When it is the what? To the left, the concentration of the reactant are significantly higher than that of the product. So we can look at the point in time, depending on the situation of the reaction, to say that equilibrium can either go to the right, which is the product, or to the left. And we're going to be using these terms often as we move on. So how can we now quantify equilibrium? You see, we can quantify equilibrium using two ways. Number one, what we call equilibrium expression. Equilibrium expression, or the formula, simply means writing the formula of equilibrium based on what we call the mass action law. But I'm not going to be going into that a lot in this class. So it relates the equilibrium constant and the reactant and product concentration. Remember what we said, at equilibrium, the reactant and product concentration do not change at that point in time. So those equilibrium concentrations and the relationship to this constant is what we call equilibrium expression. And it is written in such a way, according to the law of mass action, the product must be the numerator and the reactant must be the denominator. Or you can say the right, and remember the right is always the product and the left is the reactant. So it is represented by KEQ. So if I want to write it now, something important need to be, if you look at this, the coefficient, let me talk about it. I'm going to use green. You see, that's not what I want. I want pen. Okay. You see, the coefficient play an important role. I wrote the coefficient with lowercase letters. Now, the D here is the identity of each of the species involved in the reaction. Now, to write an equilibrium constant, what are we going to do? Now, KEQ will be, remember I said it's the product of a reactant. The concentration of each of these species, the concentration, I'm going to use a square bracket is used to represent the concentration. So the concentration of C means square bracket of C raised to the power of its coefficient times the square bracket of D raised to the power of its coefficient small d divided that by, remember this is the product like we have here over the reactant. The reactant is the concentration of A raised to the power of its coefficient, the small case letter, times B raised to the power of each small coefficient. Remember, what I have here is multiplication, not an addition. Students make this mistake a lot. You can say multiply, or you can say put dot. It is multiplication, or you don't have to put it at all. Just know that you are not adding. So if you do this, this is what we call, this particular expression is what we call the equilibrium expression. The whole of this, remember, the whole of this is what we call equilibrium expression. This is the expression. However, if we have the values of this C, the concentration of C and the concentration of D, and put them together and raise each of them to the power of the coefficient, we're going to have a value which we call the equilibrium constant. So the equilibrium constant is just the numerical value of what? This equilibrium expression that we have just written. That is exactly what that means. And we're going to put this into practice in the next video. Just remember again, for rehearsal, the square bracket, of course, represent, let me put it down, the square bracket, I'm going to use my red, the square bracket represents concentration of the species. That's what it means. Now, the small case letter represent, you see the small case letters represent what? The coefficient of a balanced reaction. Again, a reaction must be balanced. If the reaction is not balanced, you're not going to write a correct equilibrium distinct for it. And however, again, another important note to make is that equilibrium concentration cannot be written for pure, liquid, and solid. It can only be written for gases and aqueous solutions. And let us move with some problems here. Problem one, it says, write the equilibrium expression for the reaction below. Let us write the equilibrium expression for this reaction below. Again, remember what I told you, it is the product over the reactant. This is not necessarily the problem, but I like using this as a prompt for student. So this is going to give us, now, the product is this. The coefficient of this is 1. Remember, when it's not, it's just 1. So it's going to be N2 raised to the power of 1. You don't have to write it. If you want to write it, no penalty for that. Then water has a coefficient of 2. So it's going to put in H2O raised to the power of 2 divided by, again, we have two reactants here. We'll start with NO. So NO has a coefficient of 2. We put the square bracket raised to the power of 2. You see, I'm not putting any plus here. Just leave it this way because this is multiplication. And the hydrogen is H2. It has a coefficient of 2. This is the equilibrium expression for this reaction. Again, important, before I forget, remember, the equilibrium constant is written without a unit. KEQ is usually written without a unit. It can have unit, but at the level of this class, we're not going to talk about that. Without a unit. The unit can vary depending on the number of species involved in a balanced chemical reaction. Alright, let's do another problem again. Okay, before we do another problem, let's talk about the size of K. Now, of course, the value of K is a constant. You see, equilibrium cost is a constant. Always a constant. Except in one condition. When the temperature changes. Temperature is the only thing that can change the value of equilibrium constant. No other perturbation can change that value. And of course, remember that none of the concentration used to express equilibrium constant changes over time. So when once the equilibrium is established, those concentrations, I talked about them earlier, they never do what? They never change. Now, what is the size of K? Now, what does it mean? When K is greater than 1, what it means, greater than 1 means it has to be 1 point something. 1 point something. When it is greater than 1 and above and big enough, it indicates that the equilibrium lies towards the right. It is towards the right, or what we call the product side of the equilibrium. It is towards the right. What it means is that you have more product than the reactant. Now, when equilibrium is less than 1, what it simply tells you is that it lies towards the left or the reactant side. So you have more reactants than the product. And when equilibrium is equal to 1, we simply say that the reaction is in equilibrium. So we're going to use this to solve a few other problems as we move on. Problem 2, it says, again, write the equilibrium expression for the reaction represented by the following equation. Now let's do this again. Remember again, it is the products divided by the reactants. That's exactly what we're going to do. So again, let's write K equilibrium will give us, we have only one product here, SO3. We have to put a square bracket to represent the concentration, and then it has a coefficient of 2, we're going to put it here, divided by here, we have two species, we have SO2 here, then the coefficient here is 2, we're going to put 2, and then oxygen, remember the coefficient is 1, we're going to have O2, you don't have to put it, if you want to put it, that is fine, no penalty. This is the equilibrium expression for this reaction. Always feel free to pause this video, try these problems yourself, and try to come back and check them for comprehension. Problem 3. Now, I'm not going to bring in, this problem 3 brings in numerical values of the concentrations, and we're going to use that to calculate the true value of equilibrium constant. It says for the equation below, the equilibrium concentration is given below for each reactant and product. Calculate K for the reaction and then comment on the position of the equilibrium. So we're going to do two things. We're going to calculate the K, and then we're going to now do a comment on the position of equilibrium. And then, but before we do that, we need to go through a hurdle. What is the hurdle? First, we do what? First, we have to write the expression. First, write the equilibrium expression. If you don't write the equilibrium expression, it's like the formula. If you don't do it, you're going to be wrong. So you can't bypass that. So let us start. Of course, there's one species here. There's one here, whenever it is not written. So remember that. So if I write the equilibrium expression for this now, it's going to give me, the product is NO, so it's going to be, N has 2. So it's going to be NO raised to the power of 2 divided by N2, it just has one, so you're going to say N2 raised to the power of 1, you don't have to write that, and then O2 again raised to the power of 1. So this is the equilibrium expression, but not the equilibrium constant. What do? We now substitute the value. Now, the product is NO has this concentration. I'm going to put it in. So this is going to be 0. Do neglect the unit because we're not talking about the unit here. So it is raised to the power of 3. You have to do this. Divided by, you go to the reactant. For nitrogen, nitrogen is 0.879. However, it is raised to the power of 1 here. Because the expression is telling, is guiding us. It's the formula that we're using at this point. And then the oxygen is 0.571. Again, it is raised to the power of 1. Then if you put this into your calculator, you're going to get 0.194. That becomes the value of our equilibrium constant. Now, having gotten this value, remember what I said about the three sizes of equilibrium. When equilibrium is greater than 1, it lies to the right or the product side. Less than 1, to the left or the reactant side, equal to 1 is at equilibrium. Here now, this is what? This is less than 1. This equilibrium now is less than 1. What that simply tells you is that since equilibrium is less than 1, since KEQ is less than 1, the equilibrium does what? Favors at, you can say, equilibrium lies to the left or reactant side. Reactant side of the reaction. So that it is to the left. So what you have here is that you have more reactants than the product. That is what this is telling you. Let's go to the next problem. Again, the same thing. It says the measured equilibrium concentration for the reaction below is given to be the following. Nitrogen is this. Hydrogen is this. Ammonia is this. Say, calculate the value of the equilibrium constant and comment on the position. Exactly the same question we're talking about again. That's what it said. So that's what it's telling us. So let's do it really quickly. Again, this is the product. This is the reaction. So we're going to write it. Writing the equilibrium expression. Remember, again, the expression is product of a reactant. So this is one here. So let's start. This is NH3 to the power of 2 divide, these are two reactants. N2 here is to the power of 1 and H2 here is to the power of 3. This is the equilibrium expression. And then if we now put that everything here, it says, let's start from ammonia. What is ammonia is 1.31. So it's going to be 1.31 molar raised to the power of 2 divided by nitrogen is 0.920. 0.920 raised to the power of 1 times the next one, hydrogen. What is hydrogen? Hydrogen is 0.200. 0.200 molar raised to the power of what? 3. And if you put this into your calculator very well, you're going to get 233 approximately. This is the value of the equilibrium constant. And however, now, since K is what? Since K is less than 1, what does that tell us? Since K is less than 1, equilibrium lies to the what? Equilibrium, you can say lies, or you can say equilibrium is to what? The right. If you don't want to say the right, you can say or the product side. It is to the right or the product side. And that's how you do this problem. All right. Let's now talk about the last principle we need to talk about in this lecture. The last principle. Now, I usually tell my students, the lecture principle, I liked this thing when I was a student of chemistry in those days in high school. I liked it a lot because it tells us how to overcome adversity in real life. I tell my students, this is the law of adversity. What does it say? The law of adversity, if you don't know, it says, when you are down, don't stay down. What do? You get up. That is exactly what this law is telling us. So it's telling us that when a system is in equilibrium, so far it has achieved equilibrium, and an external stress comes around and disorganizes it, what does it do? The equilibrium will adjust itself in a direction to do what? To relieve or cancel that applied stress. And what are the stresses that can be applied to the system of equilibrium? There are different types of stresses. It could be additional removal of the reactant, additional removal of the product, We can change the temperature, we can change the volume, change the pressure, or add or remove catalyst. And we're going to be taking this one after the other in this class. What about the reactants? What implication has the change of the reactant and product has to do in a reaction? Now we're going to have a very good, we're going to do this with this equation. Again, this is formation of ammonia equation that we're going to use here. Now, if you add reactant, the two reactants we have is nitrogen and hydrogen. If you add it, what does it do? Let me give you an example of something again. Now, if this is, let's call this a balance, a seesaw, and then you have someone is staying here, and it the weight on both sides are equal, right? If you have the weight on both sides are equal, and then you added a weight to this point. If you add a weight to this point, what happens? You see, the equilibrium will first adjust, will first fall and fall this way because a weight has been added. What do you do next? This is what the problem will cause. So this is the stress. To cancel this stress, what do you do? To bring it back up, what are you going to do? You're not going to want to add something to the right. So now you're going to want to add something to this side. And if you add that into that side, what happens? Let's see. You are now bringing it back up. So if you add something here now, remember you already have something here, and you now added another stuff here to the right to bring it back up to be normal, to bring it back up. Now, what have you done? Let me tell you what you've done there. You've simply obeyed the Lochatelier's principle. That's exactly what you've done. This system was disorganized by the additions of something to the left, by this way. To put it back, you added something to the right. So typically what you did to adjust this equilibrium is to move it to the right. That's what you've done. So this equilibrium has moved to the right. We're going to use this knowledge and talk about how this happens. That's exactly how you add reactants and product. Let's see what happens here. So at first, if you add any of the product, if you add any of this, let me use this. If you add any of this guy or this guy, what is going to happen? This is in equilibrium. Everything is at constant. If you add it, you become too much of this. So for you to reduce the too much of this, you're not going to take it away and throw it. What is it going to do? It's going to go to the right. So anytime you add these guys, it's going to move to the right. So here, it's going to move what? To the right. The equilibrium will shift to the right to bring itself back to normal. That's exactly what happened there. You add it, and to correct it, it has to move on this side to bring it back. So you're going to add itself back to the right to reduce the concentrations of those reactants that you added. That's exactly what happens. Now, if you remove the reactant now, if you remove them, let me use a different app. So removal of this guy. If you remove any of this guy, what is happening here? If you remove any of these ones, you are doing what? You are now making it smaller. It's not already equal. It's not, you're not disorganizing it. So to replace that thing you remove, what is it going to do? The reaction is going to move this way from this side. So it's going to move towards this side. So what will happen? It's going to shift to the left because some part of ammonia is going to break down to replace this. So equilibrium will shift to what? To the left. So we're going to say it will shift to the left side. To do what? To replace the values or the concentrations of the reactant that have been removed. Again, if you add more product, let's see, this is a product now. There should be good this way. You add more of this. Again, let's see. You add this one. It becomes too much in excess. To reduce it, where does it go? It goes to the left to reduce it. So this is going to work the left side. And as I tell my students, you can just do this. I take it. It doesn't matter. This means to the left. And again, when you remove this product, like in the last one, if you remove ammonia, the equilibrium does not exist in a vacuum. You have to replace it. To replace ammonia, nitrogen and hydrogen have to react to replace it. And what is it going to do? Reacting to replace this will shift it to what? To the right. It will go to the right or this way. So this is the effect of reactants and products per se on a system in equilibrium. Now let's look at temperature. Remember, I told you temperature is the only thing that changes the value of equilibrium. Now, however, for us to figure out the effect of temperature on equilibrium or the position of effect of temperature, what temperature will do to a system in equilibrium, we have to treat it as a product and reactant knowledge. What does that mean? Remember that when we did two types of reactions, we said exothermic and endothermic. In endothermic reaction, what actually happened? In endothermic reaction, heat is at the product side, heat is needed for the reaction to occur. In exothermic reaction, In endothermic reaction, heat is needed for the reaction to occur. So heat is at the reactant side to be endothermic. You have it at the reactant. However, in exothermic reaction, heat is at the product side. So this reaction is an exothermic reaction because heat is what? This is exothermic. Because heat is at the product side or energy, whichever way. Now, we're going to predict it the same way we predicted the reactant and product principle in the movement of equilibrium. That is what we're going to use. What does that mean now? If heat is a product, what it means is that you're adding more product in this reaction anytime you're adding heat when you increase temperature. So that is exactly what this means. So in the other case, when heat is at the right side, is a reactant, is endothermic, we'll treat heat there as a reactant. So here now we're going to treat this heat as a product. So this is a product of the reaction. Now, having said that, let's see what happens. So increase in temperature simply means addition of heat. So if you're adding heat, it's like you're adding product. Remember, in the last thing we did, if you're adding product, what happens? You're going to shift it to the left. That's exactly what happened. So if you're adding more of this heat, it will be too much heat. The heat needs to be removed. Well, to remove this heat, you only have only one direction to move to the left. So it will shift it to what? The left. It will move to the left side of the equilibrium to remove excess heat, to remove the excess heat that have been added. That's exactly what happens. And on the other hand, decreasing heat means cooling down or removal of heat. Decreasing temperature, I mean. Decreasing temperature means cooling down or removal of heat. So decreasing heat means, okay, remember the first one, I talked about adding heat. That adding heat means doing this. Adding heat. So what about removal of heat? In removal of heat, let me use green, means you are removing heat. If you are removing heat means, in this case, you are removing the product, right? If you're removing the product, that's what it means. You're removing the product, so you need to replace it. How do you replace it? The reaction has to move what? To the right. So it's going to move to the right or the product side. If you're to the right or the product side, to replace, remove the heat. You have to replace it. That's exactly what is happening at this juncture. Now, let's talk about pressure and volume effect. Pressure and volume effects have an inverse relationship. But first, we need to talk about the volume. Volume is proportional to the number of moles. There's a gas law involved here, but we don't talk about it much. Volume is proportional to number of moles. Exactly. Now, what that simply means is that anytime there is high increase in volume, you know, proportional means directly related. So if you increase volume, you increase the number of moles. However, in a balanced chemical reaction, we don't call it moles, we call it volume. So we're going to use our knowledge of volume or knowledge of mole, to talk about this. So what it simply means is that if you increase in volume, it favors the direction with more moles because volume is proportional to number of moles. So, and decrease in pressure or, decrease in volume will favor direction with less number of moles. So like I have at the second one. Now, the effect of this volume is opposite of pressure. In pressure, pressure and volume, of course, is inversely related. If you know, remember the Charles law, pressure is inversely related to volume. Now, what happens here is that increase in pressure will favor the side with less number of moles or with less volume because pressure is inversely proportional to volume. And decrease in pressure will favor the side with what? You see, remember again, let me come back. Increase in pressure will favor the side with less number of moles or more or less volume. Whereas decrease in pressure will favor the side with more number of moles. So if you decrease the pressure, you're going to have it to the direction with more. So what are you going to do in this kind of reaction? You're going to count the coefficient of a balanced chemical reaction on both sides. So if I have this reaction, I used it a couple of times. If I have this plus this, and this is in equilibrium, and it gives me this. Remember, I wrote it a couple already. Now, I'm going to calculate the number of moles on each side. Remember, in this reaction now, we're going to have one mole here, going to three moles, going to what? Two moles. Now, in this case, you want to tally up the total number of moles on both sides. On both sides, we have how many moles? Let me use my green. This will have four moles. This side, you have what? Only two moles. Now, we believe, according to Okay, let's leave the law. Let me not confuse you. Now, according to this statement, the volume is proportional to the number of moles. Four moles simply means four volume units. That's what we believe. This means two volume units. So what it simply tells you is that if you increase the volume of this reaction, it's going to favor the direction with more number of moles, which is to the left. And decrease in volume will favor the side with less number of moles. So we are counting the number of moles, not the volume itself. So we're going to assume that those mole units is proportional to the volumes in a particular volume unit. So we're going to practice these two in the next few problems. He says, which direction will equilibrium shift when the following changes are made? I'm putting all the problems together in Lotrobius principle for us to say all this at the same time. So let's start. Remember, addition of reactant means you are adding more of it. So if you're adding reactant, it's addition of reactant, we have two reactants. If you're adding this or adding this, what is going to happen? Adding any of this will make them to be too much. So they have to move to the right. So I'm going to say to the right to reduce that. Anytime you add the reactant, which is nitrogen dioxide or water. Removal of the reactant means you're removing these ones. You're doing what? If you're removing them, you're making them smaller. To replace them, it has to come from this side. So it's going to go to the what? To the left to replace them back. Let's go to the product. We have two products as well. Now, if you add more product, you're making them too much. So what's going to happen? You have too much product here. To reduce them, they have to go to the what? It's going to be to the left. Remember, adding them now. I'm adding them here. And then, if you're going to remove them, what happens now? If you remove them, if you cut it, that means you're taking them away. If you take this away, the volume will not reduce the concentration. To replace the concentration, it has to go to this way. So this is going to be to the right. You can always pause this video and try out this, particularly with the knowledge of the one we talked already, to understand actually the effect of these changes in stress on a system in equilibrium. The next page, the same question and the same equation that I have too. Now we're looking at increase or decrease in temperature. Remember, we're going to determine what type of reaction is this. Heat is to the right. Anytime heat is at the right side of the reaction, that reaction is what? Endothermic. So in endothermic, heat is a reactant. And if heat is a reactant, let's take it off from there. If you increase in temperature, means addition of this heat more. That's what I mean. So if you add more heat, so let's say if you add heat to this, there will be too much heat. To reduce this heat, it has to go to the right. So this is going to go to the right to dissipate the excess heat that has been added. Again, if you decrease the temperature, means removal of heat. If you remove this heat, it's going to go back to the left to replace it from this side. So this is going to be to the left. To the left. Good. So if you don't do this, you're going to struggle with trying to memorize what will be the effect of temperature. The best thing is to always figure out temperature as being what? A reactant or a product, depending on the type of reaction you encounter. Now, let's go to another one. Very interesting. The volume. Remember what I told you. In volume problems, you have to count the total number of coefficients. Let's count. Here we have 4 and 6. 4 plus 6 will give us a total of 10 moles. Here we have 7 and 4 will give us 11 moles. Remember again, volume favors, increase in volume will go to the direction with more volume. What does that mean? There is 11 moles here, there is 10 moles. So if you increase volume, volume is going to go to the what? To the right. Because the right side has more what? Products has more volume. Or more moles. Whichever way you want to put it. And then, if you decrease the volume, what is going to happen? If you decrease the volume, remember, the volume will favor side with less number of moles, which is to the left. So it will go to the left. And the left, because it has what? Left, or you can say reactants, have less moles. That's exactly what is happening at this point. Now, the last but not the least page, we still try to finish it up. So which of the following, the same reaction, the same equation, now we're talking about pressure. Remember again, in pressure, you have to count the number of moles. We counted it earlier. Here, we have 4 plus 6, 10 moles. Here we have 7 plus 4, we have 11 moles. Now, which direction? Remember I said, pressure is inversely related to number of moles. So what it means is that if you include pressure, it will follow direction with less moles. So which side have less moles? To the left. So increase in pressure will do what? We go to the left. Because the left have what? Less moles. Reactants have less moles. That's exactly what happens here. So decrease in pressure will favor direction with more moles, which is to the right. So it's going to go to the right. Because, like I told you, pressure is inversely related to volume vis-a-vis number of moles. Here to the right, because the product have more moles or more volume. Doesn't matter. Then the last but not the least, which is a good way to end it, is addition of a catalyst. Now listen, a system that has achieved equilibrium, addition of a catalyst have no effect. If a system is already in equilibrium, addition of a catalyst have no effect. The effect of the catalyst only comes before equilibrium is achieved. So a catalyst can actually enable equilibrium to be achieved on time, early enough. But that is all. When a system is already in equilibrium, the catalyst have no single effect on that system in equilibrium. And that being said, this is the end of this class. Thank you once again for listening, and do have a wonderful day, and bye.